family of faith. EWTN celebrates 15 years with Mother Angelica, Monsignor Eugene Clark, Father Mitch Pacwa, Father George Rutler, our special musical guest, Glad, and special guest, the Most Reverend David E. Foley, Bishop of Birmingham. Join us along with our co-hosts for the evening, Jeff Cavins and Raymond Arroyo. And now, Jeff Cavins.
Welcome to EWTN's 15th anniversary show. We are so happy that you have joined us. It's exciting to share this special moment with you, our viewing family, as well as our audience of EWTN employees here in the studio. We'll hear from some of them just a little bit later on in the show. Also, we want to welcome our Spanish-speaking family. You see, we're simultaneously translating this special program into Spanish. You're in for a treat, as we have some tremendous guests who are going to share in this 15th anniversary celebration. But first, let's meet the woman who dared to believe that God would do great things, Mother Angelica. Mother, it sounds like they love you.
Oh, I love them.
Listen, we're sitting here with all of the EWTN staff, and it's quite a day. 15 years.
Sitting awesome, back. Awesome years.
I like that word. You always use awesome, that word, awesome.
Yeah. Awesome.
That answers my question.
Hey, it's filled with awe, huh?
Sitting back after 15 years, 15 years ago, of course, she started work here.
The 3,000 homes.
With 3,000 homes.
Now it's 51 million.
51 million. I don't have to ask the question then. Are you surprised?
Am I surprised? Well, first, I'm surprised we haven't got into this thing, you know. That was the biggest surprise. It's not so much a surprise as awe. I hate to say this so over and over and over, but it's the only word I can find to express God's providence. Mm-hmm. See, it's that God would do this in 15 years is something I don't think anybody, including myself and my sisters, believed. I thought we'd be some little place up there and have a few we started with 4 hours a day. We'd have a few programs, and we wanted to reach the people because they didn't know Jesus. They didn't know how to live the gospel. Mm-hmm. They read the gospel.
That's one of the keys, I think, to EWTN in reading your material and your biography, evangelization. Can you comment on it? Evangelization really is one of the hearts of EWTN.
Well, I have some kind of strange ideas about evangelization. I think you have to evangelize yourself first, because you can't give what you don't possess. Mm-hmm. You know? So I think we got to start with ourselves. We don't often think of evangelizing me, because we have to be humble enough to say, I don't know enough about God. Mm-hmm. My life hasn't changed in years. I got the same faults, the same sins. There's something wrong. I think that's where it starts. And then your example evangelizes your family. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And the evangelization is nothing more, I think, than to be as loving and kind, compassionate. Sometimes you have to correct, but it has to be done. And the people you correct, your children especially, have to know that that correction is an act of love.
Mm-hmm. Over the last, I don't know how many years now, people have heard you talk about a particular scripture verse. Mm-hmm. From Revelation 14:6. What is that scripture? And share with our audience a little bit of how you see that scripture fitting into the vision of EWTN.
Well, for a long time, I could not figure out, first of all, why we were in television and why the first Catholic television network was in the South, in the Baptist belt, behind a cloister community. I mean, none of that figures out to anybody. Mm-hmm. But there had to be a reason. Well, as things have gone these last 35 years, we've been here 35 years. The last 35 years has taught us that society has changed drastically. People have changed, many for the better, and the temperature of society is not what it should be. We don't understand why or even how we offend God. And it isn't a negativeness, it's a fact that a lot of people do not know that what they're doing in particular offends God. Neither do they understand His awesome mercy, His love, His compassion, and how He hounds us and watches us and goes after us to come back. So I think as things have gotten worse and better and indifferent, I feel the 14th chapter 6th verse says what this network is doing. And there shall come from heaven an angel. That's satellite. St. John didn't say satellite, but I think he saw one. Because it has big wings, he probably thought it was an angel. All these scripture scholars are turning upside down right now over my interpretation. But I think it says, and he shall spread the good news to every tribe, every nation, every language. Mm-hmm. And our dear Lord has, the last year you can talk to any of our staff and they'll tell you, we've been pushed by the Lord. Mm-hmm. To do just that.
See? You mentioned pushed by the Lord.
Yes.
That almost hints at the fact that this is a critical time. Did you see this as a critical time, a pivotal time, not only in EWTN, but with the church?
I think it's critical that as we've traveled to South America and we've traveled to Europe and we've traveled so many places, there is, even in the faithful, a hunger that they didn't even have before. A hunger for more of God, more knowledge, more love, how to accept their crosses, their pains, their injustices and tragedies in their life. They want, there's a hunger for God. Mm-hmm. And I think when you look at television, where there's so much sex, violence, everything that fills the heart with fear of God, fear of the world, fear of people. The network, I think, it's the Lord's network, and I want to say that tonight. And thank all the people for what they've done to keep us on the air. And thank the Lord God for so many miracles that you can't even imagine.
When we talk about the network, we're not talking just about Mother Angelica. We're talking about the employees, the workers, all the people, all of our viewers around the world.
Some donkey has to pull every cart. And I'm the donkey that pulled this cart.
Okay.
God has to have our yes. See? But after that, He goes with it. And I made a bargain with the Lord when we first started. I said, Lord, we'll put it from here to there and there down. After that, it's your problem.
I like that.
And we've lived by that. We have been, I think, very faithful. You know, we don't go around with ratings. But the Lord has brought people back into the church. People have died in hospitals watching the rosary.
Really?
So they died in the Lord. It's awesome.
That's got to give you a good feeling.
Yeah.
As the donkey that led this whole thing. Okay.
But don't forget, a donkey carried him to Egypt and another donkey carried him to Jerusalem. Not bad for God.
No. No. That's exciting.
It's exciting.
That's exciting.
And you're exciting for being here.
Well, I'm looking forward to working
with
you. I'm so
glad.
This is an exciting time. Speaking of celebration, feeling glad,
yeah,
we're going to hear some music now from a group by the name of GLAD. And they have a style of music called a cappella. And for you that don't know, a cappella is without instruments. It's absolutely beautiful. GLAD has sold over 1 million albums. In their 23-year history, they have a total of 18 albums, 6 of which are in the style of a cappella. We'd like to welcome to the 15th anniversary celebration, GLAD. Do
reality, a mere reflection of what you saw in me. You can wish to me the state my heart was in. How the world has seen me again. When a way determined to take the narrow path, but in a moment my foolish ways were back. It's elementary, there must be something wrong, and I'm starting to realize this can't go on.
Wanna be a
do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do
During 1987, we had a banner year here at EWTN. We moved to a more prominent satellite and expanded our programming to 24 hours a day. It was also a year of milestones. 1987 marked the first time EWTN provided live coverage of the national meeting of the National Catholic Conference of Bishops in Washington. That same year, we sent our first overseas crew to the Philippines. But there was one monumental first for us in 1987. Do you know what it was? I'm joined by...
Bill Polk.
Bill Polk. Now, I know what he does here, but you probably don't, so I'll let him explain.
Well, my title is controller, but that's sort of an earthly title. We all know that God is in control here. So I'm sort of the one that people look to when they need money. And, of course, when we need money, we always have to look to our viewers, and they always respond.
Ah, well, Bill's the man with the ulcers around here. So our question was, Bill, before we left, what monumental first event took place in 1987? Any guess?
Okay. First of all, I've only been here about 10 months.
That's no excuse.
I know. So I twisted an arm or two at my table, and I came up with an answer, but I have an answer of my own, too.
I can only give you one. I mean,
can I give you two?
All right, 20 questions. What is it?
Okay, the folks at my table think that it was the first time that we covered the Pope's visit.
Somebody was reading the monitor. It was the first time we covered the Pope.
My answer.
Okay, all right.
This is a personal observation. I'm an accountant. I think it was the year the first accountant made it to heaven.
I better get on before another accountant makes it to heaven. Actually, it was the papal visit, as you said, in 1987. Now, since that time, EWTN has continued to present several papal visits, as you know, including the memorable World Youth Day in Denver, Colorado, as well as the Pope's most recent visit last year. Now, earlier, we mentioned that 1987 marked our first overseas shoot. In the intervening years, our next guest has taken our camera crews and you all over the world. He brought you wonderful devotions from the Holy Land, and will soon premiere a new program shot in Greece. Let's see what's up with our holy globetrotter. Jeff and Mother Angelica have him at the stage.
Thanks, Raymond. Father Mitch Pacwa is a very familiar face to EWTN viewers, as you mentioned. The first time, Mother, that you met Father Pacwa, what what gave you the idea? Did you know at that point that he was going to play a big role in the future, the program?
I didn't think that when I saw him, he would ever play any role.
Was it the blue suit?
Well, Bill brought it. You know, he talked about this wonderful priest. And so I'm waiting for this priest. And somebody walked in my office and I looked and my heart went down to my shoes. He said he didn't look like a cowboy, but I thought he looked like a cowboy.
Well, I had a hat.
He had a hat.
I had a cowboy hat.
And it was a cowboy hat and he had boots.
And it was my hunting boots.
Well, they looked like boots to me, you know. I don't know the difference. And I looked at him, he didn't have, he had, you know.
A flak jacket.
Yeah.
It was cold.
He walked in my office and I said, hello? He said, I'm Father Pacwa. I went, ugh.
And I'm your guest on tonight's show.
Yeah.
You actually hit your
and
forehead.
I went, But then I said, you going to wear that? He said, oh, no.
No. When I got gussied up.
I know.
You look, I clean up
yeah,
well.
You look like he had kind of hair. He said it wasn't long,
no,
but
was
hair.
Just,
yeah, well.
Well, Mother,
he was absolutely wonderful. He had one of these midget...
Mandolins,
yes. He played that, too.
At what point, Mother, did you realize that Father Mitch was going to be a part of the programming of EWTN?
Middle of the show.
Well, during the show, I realized that he was really full of God, and it didn't look like full of God when I first saw him. But I realized he was. He really loved the Lord. He was a scripture scholar. He was just everything a priest should be. And I was very excited. And we've had him back, and we pay him $5 for every program he makes.
Not everyone.
What's your side of it, Father?
Yeah. It's pretty
the
close.
Last
pretty
of the
close.
Big
We, as a matter of fact, the first show, I was a graduate student at Vanderbilt University. And in the first show, I said, well, let's talk about how we got the canon. You know, scripture. You know, how do we know what books belong in the Bible?
Right.
And I was doing some of that. We were just going, and in the... Or the end of the show, said, you know, this is so much fun. We're just going to bump the rest. That's the great thing about going in your own network. If you're having a good time, you can just bump the other shows right off.
Right.
So we did. We went on for 2 hours.
We used to do that a lot.
I know. Then you wore out the audience. Those poor folks, they'd be there for 2 hours. Listen, we just talked about
it. You've gone all over the world for us.
Oh, well, you know, this is one of the things that has happened. You know, in that first show, you said to me, I want you, you just leaned over and said, I want you to do a series. And I couldn't believe it. I was just amazed. And came back and did a series on the Psalms, because Scripture, Old Testament in particular, is my area. And so, and I love it, and I love it. But we were doing it in the studio.
I really asked you because you looked like a Jewish rabbi.
Well, everybody thought that, too. Remember, we were getting two letters a week asking when I converted. My people were Polish, sir. But, you know, in Poland, maybe there's a lot of Jews in the woodpile. I don't know. But they, you know, they, all of us part may be Jewish. And that'd be an honor. But the thing that I saw is that as we did the network, you know, the shows on the Bible, here in the studio, we would have a picture. I'd try to describe things, but it's not the same.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, two things strike me over the years as what's developed. One is, I've learned how to switch cameras and, you know, and how to deal with things here in the studio. But also being able to develop this style of doing the programs on the Bible at the places where they happened. Uh-huh. Now, the Rosie was the big break. Now, let me tell a story on Mother Angelica. I had been given an offer from the government of Israel to go over there. Mother was afraid. She said, no, we can't do it. It's too dangerous, all this stuff. She was even nervous.
I know when she shot up.
Well, you didn't want or the cameras or the crew. She liked the cameras or the crew.
Especially the cameras.
New talent.
They're very expensive.
They are.
They're hard to come by.
So, but then I said, wait a minute. I just want, because I knew that we should go there. I wanted to pray over it. I prayed over it, and I came out, and I said, I went over to see you on one of the anniversary shows. And maybe it was about the 10th anniversary. And I said, Mother, how about if we went over to Israel and videotaped the rosary? It took you all of 5 seconds to say yes.
It was also what we wanted.
Mm-hmm. We want to have the people pray.
It's beautiful.
And people pray it.
Oh, yeah.
That it wasn't just teaching. It was that. It's helping people to realize that the Holy Land is not, you know, Never Never Land or some part of that Disney world. We still want to get that Mickey and that Donald to go to confession, don't we? But the Bible's a real place.
All the rest of them, too.
We want the Bible that took place in a real country. We see it, but we pray it.
Yeah.
And that opened up the way, because the next year I got a phone call from people from the government of Jordan. And they said, Father, do this for the Arabs, too. And so they helped the finance doing the station.
Wonderful.
And now and the travel agent that I've been working with has been helping us with thousands of dollars to finance, you know, from Consolidated Tours, to bring our crew over to do teaching series.
Yeah.
You know, so that...
What did you do in Greece?
It was wonderful. We went over to Macedonia. You know, we had a little more on the crew this time. We had Bob Blake. We had Tim Brown, we had Philip Golden, I got all the colors mixed up. Philip Golden is doing camera. We went over there, and because there were more of us, we were able to do a little bit more shooting. We did, for instance, in the places, like Philippi, where St. Paul went to, the first Christian city he went to. We went to the place where he baptized Lydia, the first European to be baptized. Beautiful little Greek church. Then we went to the marketplace, and we saw that the archaeologists have dug up the Bema, which is where the judges sat. That's where they beat Paul. And then they went to the prison where they kept him in there till the earthquake got him out. And then we went over to Athens, and to where St. Paul gave the speech on the Areopagus. And then over to Corinth, where he also was put on trial, and somebody else got beaten that time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we went to the cave. This is one of the best. Poor old Philip was over there just trying to get things filmed. We went to the cave of the place where St. John wrote the book of Revelation. So you quoted the book of Revelation. Mm-hmm. I went there. And it's a beautiful Greek Orthodox church. One of the things that we did that was such a beautiful experience for me and the pilgrims is that while we went to Crete, we went to the church of St. Titus. This is where his skull is. And it was covered with silver and gold and jewels. It's beautiful. So you can still see the skull part. And one of the things that we wanted to see that they canceled some of the other tours because it was a national day of mourning, so we went to this church instead. And the priest saw that we weren't just, you know, tourists. We were pilgrims. There's a big difference.
Yes.
We don't want to see sights. We wanted to pray. Mm-hmm. We want to know more about the faith. So he started showing us more of his church.
Mm.
And he even let us see the Blessed Sacrament. They also reserved the Blessed Sacrament because the Greek Orthodox, and we share that, mm-hmm. that faith together in the priesthood. And then he let me do some filming there. You know, Tim and Philip and Bob got us, you know, mm-hmm. there to shoot inside the story of St. Titus converting Crete. And so we got just marvelous stuff. And all I hope is for the future, we can do tons more
yes.
to explain the rest of the sacred scriptures.
That's exciting.
One of the things I love, many things I love about Father Barclay is his enthusiasm.
Right.
He makes the scriptures so alive.
You know that even before I came back to the Catholic Church, I would watch Father Pacqua.
Oh, yeah.
And I used to get so excited. In fact, I stole your material for my sermons.
Oh,
aiding and abetting the enemy, eh?
Father Mitch, well, we've almost run out of time. Before this segment ends, I call you the man of many languages. Would you bless our viewing audience in Hebrew?
Kim, to the day. Yevarechachem Adonai Ha'av Ba'ben Baruch HaKodesh Elohim Achad Amen.
Amen.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful.
And
Raymond is with us, and Raymond is has some more trivia.
A few weeks ago, Father Benedict Groeschel was here taping some new episodes for his series. He's another one of our famous and favorite priests about here. Knowing he would not be able to join us this evening, he taped this special message. Here it is.
I was very disappointed to find out that I could not be here for the 15th anniversary of EWTN. Unfortunately, my book of appointments gets taken about a year or two ahead of time, and so I can't be at the festivities, and I'm grateful to have this opportunity to express my appreciation, my gratitude, my respect for Mother Angelica and to the whole group of people who work at Eternal Word, especially the cloistered sisters who pray for this wonderful work of God and the friars of EWTN, of the Eternal Word Mission. I'm grateful to each of the staff who always treat us with great courtesy. You know, what we get when we come to EWTN is no salary. The government requires them to give us a $5 bill, but we always give it back. But you do get warm southern hospitality and a beautiful, prayerful oasis where you run into an immense number of devout people who love the kind of spirituality and prayerfulness of Eternal Word Television. I'm very delighted to be part of it. It does have its drawbacks. First of all, I get a tremendous amount of mail that I can never answer. And if you've written to me and you haven't heard from me back, it's finally because I had to just not answer a couple of hundred letters that had piled up for so long that it was silly to answer them. And that's a problem because I live with this big pile of mail behind me, and I write letters whenever I'm not doing something. Also, it's very inconvenient to run through an airport or railroad station when you're late, and somebody comes up and says, "Father, I know you're from EWTN." It's even more disconcerting when they say to me, "Father Andrew, it's so wonderful to see you." Then I have to stop and explain that I'm not Father Andrew, we just look alike. One day I was really taken off guard. I was running through an airport, and a lady came up to me and she said, "Oh, Father, I love your program so much. I like to watch you, and then I like to watch Father Benedict." I said, "Well, you must think I'm Father Andrew." She said, "Oh, no, you're Father Rutler." So I told Father Rutler, who's very neat and shaven and looks quite proper, that the lady thought that I was Father Rutler, and he hasn't quite recovered yet. Seriously, I'm very grateful to Mother Angelica. I'm grateful to all at EWTN, and I'm grateful to you that we have this opportunity to preach the gospel of love and life, the gospel of Jesus Christ, to the United States and around the world. God bless you.
Welcome back to EWTN's 15th anniversary special. I'm Raymond Arroyo, and I have here with me
Lisa Gould.
Now, Lisa, what do you do here for the network?
I'm the Vice President of Viewer Services.
vice president. Now, we asked a question before we went to break. What event, what world event, was instrumental in bringing the mass to our viewers earlier than expected?
I don't know if I can follow the two trivia experts before me, but it's interesting how you said that that Mother had okayed for the mass to be said earlier, because at that time I was teaching theology in a high school, and before school we had morning mass, and our chapel was packed with high school students. And the reason was because a lot of their families had gone off to war. Now, I don't know if this is the right answer, but I'm going to say the Persian Gulf War.
It was the Persian Gulf War. I didn't ask for a biography. I asked for an answer. But it was, she got it right. It was the Gulf War, which caused the mass to air earlier than expected. And it was your overwhelming response, which has led to the increased number of masses each week, 7. We're there all day, every week. It's a true testament to the true value of daily devotion and the importance of that awesome sacrifice in our lives. Over the last few years, our next guest has helped us better understand the enormity of the Mass, and with wit and wisdom, brought us closer to the Catholic ideal. He's on the platform now with Jeff and Mother.
Raymond, Father Rutler, as you know, has become one of our regular series hosts. We depend on him to bring our viewers a greater understanding of the faith, from ascetical theology to liturgy to church history. And I know, Mother, that over the years of EWTN, that teaching the faith, teaching the faith has been very, very important to you, and that Father Rutler has really been the backbone.
Father Rutler has a real knack of, well, he's got a sense of humor, for one thing. It's kind of dry. He doesn't laugh at anything or smile. But, you know, after he said it, it hits you like a rock. And he keeps going on like he didn't say anything. It's an amazing gift he has. But he really can explain why we believe in what we believe and what's wrong with the kind of watered-down doctrine and everything else that we have going around in the church and the world everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
We really appreciate you, Father.
Well, thank you, Mother, and happy anniversary.
I think he's lost more hair, though, since he's been here.
Bad hair day. That's what you do to me, Mother.
The bad hair day.
Yeah.
You didn't mistake me for Father Groeschel.
No, no.
Do you think I look like Father Groeschel?
No, no. I don't.
I'm always mistaken for General Colin Powell.
Father Rutler, you've written a book recently about the crisis of saints. And in that book, you talk about the crisis of saints. And I'd like you just to comment on that for a moment and how EWTN has responded.
Yeah.
Well, I think the key is that word response. We're always looking for signs. The Lord says that a faithless generation seeks signs. One sign will be given, the sign of Jonah. Jonah was buried 3 days. Well, this is the prophecy of the Passion, of the cross. And all along our Lord's teaching way, he was telling the apostles that they simply must be with him. He would take care of things. Mm-hmm. They'd have their cross, and then they would see what the cross was all about. So we simply have to respond to our Lord. It's clear that that's what EWTN has done. It's clear that's what the saints have done. There have been a lot of celebrities in history and a lot of famous people in history who charted their own course. But it was only their own course. The greatest things are done by the saints and those who admire the saints, and sinners who at least give God permission. I think that the real problem, the real crisis in our society today, is a crisis of saints, because we are not willing to give God permission. Now, you look 15 years ago, you had no idea what was happening. We don't know what's going to happen a year from now or 15 more years from now. I was just thinking tonight, as a matter of fact, I hadn't realized this. The network was launched, the Feast of the Assumption,
mm-hmm.
15 years ago. 3 weeks later, the Nativity of Our Lady, I was ordained.
Oh, really?
No.
How
and I had no idea about what you were doing or anything.
God's providence, huh?
Anything else. But all these threads weave their way into this tapestry.
Mm-hmm.
But I think people worry too much. Our Lord told us about the dangers of worrying too much. Now, certainly we have been counseled by the Pope himself to prepare for the next millennium. But he's pointed out that the year 2000 is a symbolic date. What we have to do is always be at the disposal of our Lord and not be anxious. And that goes two ways, I think. It applies to the people who think that, as you said, you have to water down doctrine to make it more palatable. Well, nobody likes it, anything that's decent that's watered down.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And if you water down doctrine, you're patronizing people and you're betraying people. You are not giving them the essential doctrine that they need to follow our Lord. On the other hand, there are a lot of people who consider themselves very Catholic, more Catholic than the Pope, who are always anxious that the faith is not going to be there if they don't preserve it. Well, we do have to stand up for the faith, and we have to defend the faith. But the faith is not preserved in formaldehyde; it's preserved in human hearts that trust that God is in charge. So, and if we don't look at things that way, we will be anxious whether or not whether somebody's heterodox or considers themselves orthodox. And this is the whole point. Orthodoxy is not enough. You mentioned the backbone. You have to have backbone. You have to be willing to represent the faith and live the faith.
Yeah. That's what I like about Father.
Tells it like it is.
Yeah, tells it like it.
That's exciting.
It's awesome. I am every day, Father, I am so, I'm going to say it again, awestruck at what God does for us. And he's doing it for the people. You know, we're an instrument in his hand. But we have letters that come in and say, I'm 75, but that's not too old, 75, you know. And I've never known so much about my faith. See, that's what's so important, is to tell them that great banquet table that's there, and they just have to go and eat. But they don't know that.
Well, the people seem bored with the faith. They haven't...
Yeah.
Encounter that you cannot be bored with the faith, because faith is trust in our Lord. There were a lot of people in those 3 years of our Lord's ministry who were very threatened by him, who got angry at him, and of course far more people were deeply moved by him. Well, they all were moved by him, they just responded differently, but there's not any record of anyone being bored by him. So if somebody says they're being bored during a sermon, or they're being bored during a classroom talk, it's simply that they have not been encountering our Lord. They're getting an imitation. And we've been, and just because we put the name Catholic on the signboard outside the university or outside the church is not a guarantee that we are being faithful to our Lord, who's given us these great gifts of culture. Recently I was in France, right in the heart of the castle country, the chateau area, and here, you know, some of the most wonderful castles in the world: Chenonceau, Chambéry, Vaux-le-Vicomte, and tourists were going in buses past them all to go to Euro Disney to see this Plaster of Paris castle, you see. And it's a kind of symbol of our culture today. People,
yeah,
passing our Lord to find a guru, to some kind of hero, or some kind of bureaucracy that will give them the kingdom of heaven.
No, that's so true. So true.
Father, what you're saying makes me think of the young people in our society today. The young people in our society today are not looking for a watered-down gospel.
No.
They're looking for those two things: the faith, something solid, and they're looking for people with courage, people who dare to believe. And that leads right into our next song from the group that we just enjoyed just a few minutes ago, Glad. They have a song that really fits this well: Christ the Solid Rock. This is Glad.
Ba-da-ba-da.
Going to throw it to Jeff. I don't know what I'll throw, but anyway, that was a great sensation. But it's not Jeff, it's Arroyo.
Arroyo?
Arroyo.
That's, she's just boning up for the Latin American feed. They don't have to translate that one. I'm here with Jeff. Now, Jeff, you've had all these Catholic luminaries really sitting before you and coming before you tonight. What are your final thoughts as you look out and as we wind this up?
Sure. I think that in looking back at this program and sitting and listening to Mother, I'm reminded of the gospel that teaches about the feeding of the 5,000. Because when I think about the feeding of the 5,000, I think about Mother. Anytime, you know, the situation in the feeding of the 5,000, you have 5,000 people plus that are very, very hungry and very little food around. And Jesus says, "You feed them." And, of course, they look shocked. And we don't have anything. Well, Jesus says, "Give me what you have." So they give the little that they have, the 5 loaves and the 2 fish. He takes it, he blesses, and then he breaks. And then he gives it to them and he says, now after they're lined up in groups of 50 and 100, you go feed them. You can imagine how silly the disciples must have felt at that point, you know, facing the people. They give the food to the disciples. What do when you're out? You go back to Jesus. And then they keep this up. And pretty soon you realize, I'm moving in the supernatural here. Something is happening beyond me. And that reminds me of Mother Angelica. You see, here's a woman, a nun, who God said, feed my sheep. Go out into the world, feed the people, evangelization. What do you have? Well, I don't have very much. Give it to me. He takes it, he breaks it, he multiplies, and now we're going all over the world, which tells me that little in the hands of Jesus is a lot. And you know that you and I as viewers, we can do the same thing. The little that we have, a little loaf, a little fish, give it to Jesus. He will take it and do marvelous things.
And, you know, our viewers do so much of that work for us, too. They send us what they have. They pray for us. And there's another gift that they give us that Mother really inspires, and she's going to hate me for saying this. When I first came here, I was struck by the asthma Mother struggles with, her back pain, and how she offers all of that up to Jesus, and it really perfects our work. And if she's taught me one thing, and I think a lot of our viewers, it's that that pain shouldn't be wasted. It needs to be offered up, and that too can be a sacrifice and can be multiplied in a glorious way. Mm-hmm. And that's really a lovely thing. So we're going to go back to Mother now and have her wrap up and give her final reflection on this 15th anniversary. We love you.
Well, I think this hour passed too quick, don't you think? It looks like we just started, and here we are, about to say goodbye. I have to take this opportunity of thanking you from the bottom of my heart. There have been many times, and they seem to be closer together recently, that I've had to come and say to you, oh, here I am again. I'm this much in the hole. You've always responded. And I am grateful for that, because one of the things that I want to compliment the Lord on, you know, we never begin a month, and this is awesome, we never begin a month with any money for the next day, hardly. And this poor comptroller that you saw, he called me up once in a while. He says, well, Mother, we're so many hundred thousands in the hole. And my first thought is, what do you want me to do about it? You know? And I know what he means, and you find that tremor in his voice. And I say, Lord, you know, I don't have anything. And so I come on the air and present you with my few loaves and just a few fish, and all of a sudden the basket is full again to go on another month or two or three. And what's so wonderful is that the Lord has touched children. I'm surprised at how many young children listen. And they're little ones. I had a man call me up and he said, Mother, I have a 3-year-old son, and he knows when you're coming on, and he runs to the TV. And he said, I don't mind that he's enthused. And he said, my wife and I start to talk, he'll go, shh. And he said, I don't mind that, except he goes up to the screen before you leave and gives you a kiss. And he said, I don't even mind that, except when he's eating ice cream. And then the 6-year-old who called and said, Mother, will you pray that my mother comes home for Christmas? Or the child that was alcoholic at 14 and said, Mother, do you know when you're alcoholic? If you pass out, are you in trouble? Yeah, you're in trouble. And we were able to go and have someone go to her house and explain to her parents they had a problem and they should help. And all the souls that the Lord has touched over these 15 years, we couldn't even count. The Lord is like a hound. And he goes after his sheep everywhere. And even in those places, as we go from one satellite to another satellite, and we reach from the South Pole to the North Pole, and all the way around in the jungles, and the deserts, and ice-capped mountains, where there isn't a soul, or ever was a soul, that word is falling down, either by radio or television, and that word will be fruitful one day. Because the Word of God is always truth. Your Word and my Word are just like air. You know? It's a mist. But God's Word is awesome. And it brings life. And the Eucharist brings life. And that's what people feel when they come here. People tell me they turn their radios off when they start coming down the road. Why? Feel that presence. The presence of the Eucharist. And they go there and sit. And that's why I went on television, see? I want that awesome presence that's here to go through all the mechanics and all the electronics it takes to get to your home. And I want you to feel that, the same awesome Eucharistic presence. Because He is your Lord, and He promised to be with us to the end of time. To the end of time, He'll be with us. He'll never leave us. No matter how bad things are in our home and our world and our country, He is with us. Why do we worry? Why? And you know, our greatest witness is not television or radio or evangelization. When it's all said and done, our greatest witness is His providence. It isn't what we have done that people are going to marvel at. It's how He did it. In a world of materialism and profits and portfolios, that this was done hand to hand and heart to heart with each other here, our sisters and brothers, and all of you there. You're more than family. You own a network. And this is it. You have blessed us, and we bless you. We bless you with all the blessings in the heart and the church and every bishop and priest in the whole world. We ask our dear Lord to bless you. And pray for us, huh? Pray for us so that we will reach every soul and every inch of ground in this universe, even the stars that obey God's will by a twinkling just for you. I love you and thank you so much.
Thank you for joining us for this encore presentation of Mother Angelica Live. Be sure to listen each Tuesday and Wednesday evening at 8 p.m. Eastern for the live presentation of Mother Angelica Live here on WEWN.
Teach us, good Lord, to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not ask for any reward, save that of knowing that we do your will.